Hi, my name is Ethan Moore, and my philosophy of education, just to open up, it's a child-centered type of environment. So when I say that, I mean, as a teacher, I want to become friends with the students. I don't want to be a teacher and just that. I want to connect with them, their families, and really make that intertwine, really mesh well, so I can aid in their learning. So let's get started. So I want to start out just with a basic definition of what I think, and from what the internet told me as well, what philosophy of education is. Through this course, I've learned that the philosophy of education is a set of related beliefs that influence what and how students are taught. In other words, every teacher is going to have a different set of philosophies that they'll follow in order to teach a classroom. And you'll get to know mine as we go through this presentation. The philosophy of education represents answers to questions about the purpose of schooling, the teacher's role, and what should be taught by what methods. So as I said, you're going to have different methods, you're going to have different teachers, and this is where you're going to see different types of classrooms and environments really mesh, come together, and this is where you see those different philosophies. So before I begin with my philosophy, I want to stress on how important it is to pay attention to the child development and the aspect of their brain changing over time. I think children's learning is constantly developing, and I think that's important to take into account when you're teaching a classroom full of these children, that you have different levels of where they're at as in their learning capacities, as well as their environments at home. A continuous interaction between biology and experience. So as I said, that family can kind of be part of that biology. And as a teacher, you need to focus on actually their physical attributes as well as how that family kind of comes into play. And that's where the biology comes in. Experiences in the classroom, group work, which you'll see is a big part of my philosophy. And this is where you'll get to know all those things. So another thing I want to stress on is the importance of child-adult relationships. I feel that so much students get in the habit of, and teachers for that matter, get in the habit of kind of looking at a teacher as this leader, which they are, but in a sense that they're untouchable and they can't communicate purposely with them. I think that as a teacher, you need to become friends with the students, not just to, you know, teach them for a better sake and get them to the next level, but also make a connection with them and especially their families, because when you do that, you're gonna open their eyes a little bit and know that they can talk with you and come to you if they need anything. Really opens up the aspect of asking questions, them getting the answers, and you can really help them become better in all aspects of life in that matter. So my focus, as I said, student-centered philosophies. I want to focus on individual needs of the student, and I want to prepare students for a changing future. And this comes with that meshing of the family, the classroom, the environment, group work, everything like that. I want real-life scenarios in my classroom. Students and teachers work together on determining what should be learned and how best to learn it. Therefore, if I'm teaching something, I want to be the best at how I can teach that certain aspect of whatever that may be. And then I want the students to connect on the same level as where I'm at, but also leading them in a more kind of leaderist kind of way. Progression is key, and I think that the best way to do that is being on the same level playing as the students, or at least trying to be. Here I have a picture of the student-centered classroom. We have inquiry-based learning. Teaching is adjusted to meet students' needs. Technology is utilized, learning is relevant. Reflection is necessary, and that's a big one, because you could go through and teach as long as you want, but if you can't concentrate and talk to each individual student as a whole, then they can't have a chance to reflect and tell you how they feel about what you just taught them or how you could even work on becoming a better teacher in that matter. Preparing students for success, that's the big one. You want to, no matter what you do in the classroom, the biggest thing, no matter you get an A, B, C, you want them to succeed to the next level. And that's what we're doing here with the student-centered classroom. And that's why I like that kind of philosophy so much, because it's more than just sitting up here lecturing for that and just, you know, telling the students, yeah, sure, you know, good job, this or that. Connect with them, you know, get them to where they can be confident on their own. So when I look at psychologists, the big one for me was Yatsky, his sociocultural theory. I think that Gatsky is one of the best when it comes to early childhood learning. This is because of his, he has these three or four categories, and I list a couple here. The first one is the zone of proximal development. And this is the range of tasks that children cannot do independently, but can do when helped with a more competent person. And this is where, so if I was teaching a classroom, I have a group of students, they're struggling a little bit on their own. I'll observe that, and I can see that. So then what I'll do is, going off of Gatsky's is ZPD, I'm gonna go up and say, you know, I'll aid them. I'm not gonna root for them, but I'll aid them and tell them, you know, hey, I'm here, what's the problem? And I'll work through with them. And I think that's another big thing about, you know, the zone of proximal development. Next one, intersubjectivity. Here we have the idea that children come to a problem with their own subjective ways of making sense of it. They may eventually become mutually agreed upon in understanding from the teacher. So here, this is where students are presented with a problem or a conflict. Maybe it's supposed to be there, you know, for them to work on and adjust to. But in other words, every different student in that classroom, they're gonna have a different intersubjectivity. They're gonna have a different thinking to how to handle that problem than the person sitting next to them, the person to wherever they may be, and in the world for that matter. So as a teacher, you need to kind of work together, come on both ends, meet those needs, and be one and talk with them, and understand that, you know, hey, we might see this differently, and I might know more about it, but you're not saying this, but, you know, and then you level out, and then you can come to a place where you both agree, and you both can come to a conclusion, and that is gonna help the student be more confident in what they can do, and they're gonna know, hey, I can be independent, I'm gonna beat her, okay, or him. And that's good. That's good competition. I am a big competition guy. I love it. All right, so we got the next one, and this is Gatsky's social cultural theory continued. Here we have a picture of him, but we have scaffolding. Now, scaffolding is pretty much what it says. When you're building something big and successful, you need scaffolding to prepare it. So this is basically assistance by a teacher or individual more competent that enables children to complete tasks they can complete independently. So basically, when you're building something, we'll say the mind for that matter, you're gonna have scaffolding, which is kind of the teachers, and they're gonna build that mind up to where it's strong enough to stand on its own. And that's where I think that scaffolding is, I think it's a great word because, you know, you get look at all these other psychologists, they have words that just, you have no idea what they mean. Well, this is pretty self-explanatory. And I think it's very good that, you know, this builds the students to be successful and competent on their own. So I also want to look at the Montessori teacher. So this is respect children in their learning. Make children the center of learning, encourage children's learning, observation is key, which I'll get into, and demonstration of lessons and learning materials, parent learning environments. Montessori is my favorite. I think it takes what a classroom in your mind looks like and makes it into a real life, different type of scenario. And you're gonna see on the next slide here, I have a picture of what a Montessori classroom looks like. I'll tell you what, if I'm a kid, I wanna be in that classroom because I see all these, I don't see lines of desks. I don't see what I'm gonna be sitting here with my head down. I'm not gonna do that here. You can see how intuitive it is. You know, you might have a teacher sitting at the desk like this, which looks like pretty much what a student could be sitting at. And it's intuitive, I love it. All the different colors, whatever it may be, I like how you're gonna have, you know, a little carpet area here where kids can get together. And you can observe in this classroom very, very nicely. As you can see, it's open, a lot of windows. This is a real nice one. But I really enjoy this type of classroom. This is the environment that I would like to have my classroom be like, because I feel that this gets children in their most natural environment, communicating, social ties, all that with their peers, and then eventually to the teacher. So here's the three basic areas of child involvement. Practical life, that's what I was getting into. You know, this is just pretty much they do what they can do in this classroom. It's care of the person as an individual and care of the environment. So we have that environment, which looked pretty inviting to a child. And we also have, you know, the care of the person as an individual. That's that self-based learning. Then we have sensory materials, control for error, expect error of the child, and work for a solution. Isolate a single strong quality in each child to help aid learning. So that's where we sit down, as I said, you know, you're gonna figure out by observing what that child succeeds at and what he fails at. You're gonna expect error. But with that error comes where you can balance that out with finding that quality that child strives in, and you can really help them succeed, and that's what lessons like them. So then we have the academic materials, writing, reading, mathematics. Now, I love the Montessori approach. This is one area where I would kind of, you know, writing before reading, I get it. You know, I think that it doesn't matter. I think that based off what we just said, if a certain child's really succeeding at reading, I'm gonna tell him, hey, read as much as you want. That's gonna really get your vocabulary up there. Maybe, and then we can start writing. Then we can start incorporating all that. And I think that makes more sense. But don't get me wrong, I still love this approach. So here we have my teaching child style, which is informal assessment, okay? Observing the children is of high importance. Keeping anecdotal records along with running record, sampling from events in the classroom, and time spent on certain tasks keep individuals, portfolios of children to gauge their progress. Okay. Purposes of observation, basically what I just said. Determine the cognitive, linguistic, social, emotional, and physical development of children. Identify interests and learning styles. Meet the needs of the individual children. Determine progress and communicate. Big ones, I love them. Okay, so here's my conclusion summary of childhood education. I want child-centered learning, which I said, focuses on the needs of the child. Observation and group work are essential. Keep the families and parents updated, huge one, put a big star next to that, and communication is key to a healthy classroom. So I just want to say thank you for listening to my presentation, and I really enjoyed this class, and I learned a lot. Thank you.